higher education has been having increasing problems. They've had problems for years, but those problems have been growing in magnitude. One statistic that was already obvious when I was starting to write the book and is even more so now is that we have nearly 2 million fewer students going to college than we did in the year 2010. So people are starting to say no to college. And of course the question is why? And well, tuition fees are obviously rising dramatically. That's slowed down a little bit in the last few years, but the affordability issue has grown since my last book that I wrote on this general topic way back in 2004. We have a employability crisis of sorts. A lot of kids are getting degrees, but when they go out to get jobs, even in this hot labor market we're in right now, they get jobs. They're not unemployed, but they're often working at Starbucks or baristas, or they're working at Walmart or Home Depot or some store like that. And they're not getting jobs using the skills that are usually associated with a college degree. And lastly, I don't want to give you too long of an answer here, the last big problem is a learning problem. We don't think much about it. Are kids really learning a lot while in their college? Are they leaving with a lot more than they came in? Learning in a way that would make them better citizens, would make them more better productive workers, make them more honest, greater integrity. What is it they're getting out of college? Well, this is often very difficult to measure and very hard to measure. But what there's some little bit of evidence that says that maybe the learning is less than it should be. It's as bad as I thought, maybe marginally worse than I thought. Well, I spent a year writing the book, but I've been in the field of higher education for over 50 years. So it's a guy like me who's been around a long time that brings a perspective that perhaps is useful to the table. And the fact for the last 15 or 20 of those 50 years, I've been thinking and writing on higher ed issues. Before then, I was doing my work as an economic historian, writing books about American economic history and things like that, labor markets. And I thought I brought a perspective that is not totally unique, but is perhaps useful. And so I've taken on all of these, every dimension. And there are things we haven't mentioned, Mitch. Intercollegiate athletics would be an example of something that gets a lot of attention. A lot of people are talking about administrative bloat these days, that the universities are adding more and more administrators, people who don't actually teach or do research, but do something other than teaching and research. That is a problem. I talk about all these things in the book. I think the college community has been slow in recognizing the problem because they've been protected. They get money from state governments. They get money from private philanthropists. They get special tax breaks. They're protected. In the private economy, if you goof or make a mistake, you learn pretty quickly about it. And we have the world is littered with former great corporations. Let me mention Eastman Kodak would be a good example. 25 years ago, Eastman Kodak was at the king of the heap. It was one of America's leading corporations, number one and easily in the photography area. It has gone through a bankruptcy. It barely exists today, but its capitalization is trivial compared with most companies. And it essentially lost its way because it didn't foresee the new technology that was coming in and didn't rise to meet it or to take that technology over, become a commanding force. So they suffered dramatically. That doesn't happen in higher ed. I don't know of a major university who's in, say, the top 25 or top 50 universities, however you measure it, pick any method you want, that didn't exist 50 years ago. I mean, the list of the top 50 hasn't changed that much, a little bit here and there. Some schools have kind of inched up over the years. I suppose Stanford has inched up over the years, for example, and some have probably fallen a little bit. But everything's stable because there's no consequences of failure, because there's someone in there to sort of subsidize you and pick things up. But that's not the way it is in the free market economy. And so it's taken the higher ed community a while to realize what's going on. But now, that's what I just said is still true. A lot of very thinly endowed schools, particularly private schools, get no state money, are finding that, well, we can't make it anymore. And so some of them are starting to close. The same with sort of lower quality state universities. Public support of higher ed is waning a little bit. Some state governments are saying, well, we don't need to support higher ed that much more than we used to. So the support isn't growing as robustly as it once was. People are kind of fed up with high tuition fees or the political distortions that go on in college campuses. Political correctness, all that is another factor, particularly among the more conservative members of the community, and who are rightfully, concerned about these things. So we're starting to see some schools close. And there were five schools in the state of Vermont, little dinky state of Vermont, that closed or announced they were closing last year. And when that happens, the university presidents are getting very concerned, and so we're starting to see a little panic setting in. It's easy to criticize. It's hard. A lot of things that, in a perfect world, I could name a lot of things that should happen that probably won't happen because of the nature of the American political system, and some might say it's imperfections in our democratic process. I'm not a political scientist. I'll let others make that judgment. But there are some things that we could do. The single one thing that I think has been the biggest problem on the cost affordability front has been the federal student financial assistance programs that were put in. Well, I suppose you could say started in 1944 with a GI Bill, but didn't really become much of a factor until the 1970s. And in the last 40 years, those have grown enormously, led to high tuition fees. Colleges have raised their fees to grab the money that is available to that they can borrow. This is caused a lot of problems, including things like this administrative bloat I mentioned. All this has come about because of high tuition fees. It wouldn't have happened otherwise, I don't think. So we got to do something about to change that environment. In a perfect world, we would phase out the federal student loans. There are private solutions to the problem. When you buy a car or buy a house, you don't go to the government to buy the house. You go to someone else. And you can do the same thing with college education. We used to do it that way. Then, even now, a third or so of the people who go to college even now don't borrow any money. So we need to change that. That would be where I would start. I'm not that smart. And Adam Smith, who wrote in The Wealth of Nations, the first great work in economics, he wrote that book on the same year the Declaration of Independence came about, 244 years ago. Adam Smith in The Wealth of Nations said, well, the teaching has gone downhill at Oxford these days, because now the professors are hired by the university and they get their money no matter how good of teachers they are or not. It used to be the kids, students, gave their money to the professors, who then used those money to feed themselves. It was the revenue. And maybe we need to go back to you could call it an individual contractor model, where professors contract with some central administration to provide their services, but where most of the fee revenue goes to the professors, and then they turn around and kick some money back to the central administration to rent buildings and pay for the library and a few administrators that you really need. We have vastly too many administrators, but so, no, we need to rethink the model, that's an old, very old way of doing it. And some people look to things like online education and to electronics, and there's some promise in those areas. There's, but I think some of the old-fashioned ideas, like the one I just mentioned, also have a considerable promise. Plato wasn't always right, but when he wrote The Republic, whenever that was, 2,400 years ago, I'm really sounding old-fashioned today. I'm talking about Adam Smith and Plato, but and one of my concerns is people don't read Adam Smith or Plato as much as they should. But Plato in The Republic, you know, said roughly, necessity is the mother of invention. And that means as more and more schools start to go bankrupt or threatened with bankruptcy, they have to get creative. They have to think, well, maybe we can merge with our neighbor next door. Maybe we could have one library serve the two schools instead of having two libraries, instead of buying each of us buying a book, a new book every year for this or that. We'll only buy one book for the two schools and we'll cut the acquisition costs in half. Then someone else might say, well, why do we even need to buy books for libraries at all anymore in this day and age? No one goes to the library to take books out anymore. So we're going to rethink a lot of things that we do, and more out of a sense of desperation and panic rather than anything else. But it might work. It will lead in some cases to greater efficiency. People say, well, maybe people, why do we have kids go home for in the middle of May or some June 1st for 3 months? I mean, they're not helping pick the crops anymore. Couldn't we go around the clock, have school 12 months a year and get the kids out in 3 years instead of four, save a little money? You could even work it out so they could still do one internship in that period and get a little real world experience and still get an education in 3 years instead of four. Why aren't we doing these things? Well, I think schools, as things get more desperate, they'll think, we're going to offer the three-year degree instead of the four-year degree. We're going to use our buildings 12 months a year rather than 8 or 9 months a year, and sort of things like that. There's probably going to be quite a bit of change. But unlike some, I do think the traditional school will exist. People go to college for a multitude of reasons. They go for socialization. They go to for the same reason people join clubs. They go to make friends, to do things other than learn. Some of them spend too much time drinking or doing drugs or other things. But these are things that are part of the maturation, maturing process, the transition from adolescence to adulthood is more than just book learning. And so the traditional liberal arts college or regional universities and even major state universities will exist 30, 40 years from now. There will be some changes. There will be more role for online education and for different ways of communicating. But people want to to differentiate the best from the average and the mediocre. And the certification, the little piece of paper that we hand out, the diploma, is probably not the most efficient way of doing it. Kids spend $200,000 earning this little piece of paper. We'll probably find a cheaper way of doing it and a more efficient way, but we still need that certification. Kids still, the employers of the world want to know who is good and who is less good. And colleges do serve a useful role in determining that. And that, I think, will probably still be true a generation from now. Harvard is not going to go bankrupt. If Harvard closed tomorrow because they had no applications, they would still make $2 billion next year from endowment money. And that's true of many of the private. Duke is true. It's true at Duke. It may not be as true, say, at the University of North Carolina because it's more dependent on public funds. But that's what's so I see there will be a future for higher ed.